Hello everyone, I am Dr. Pooja Saxena. Today I am going to discuss about large intestine anatomy and function. So there are specific objectives under which we study about this. Firstly, we will describe the specific features: arterial supply, venous drainage, lymphatic drainage and nerve supply of large intestine. Secondly, we'll compare the gross anatomical features of a small and large intestine. Thirdly, we'll identify the main anatomical divisions of large intestine with blood supply and lymphatic drainage of the vermiform appendix. Fourthly, we'll identify the McBurney's point of tenderness and explain its clinical importance. Finally, we'll describe the gross anatomy of rectum and identify its peritoneal relations and the functioning of large intestine also. The large intestine comes after the small intestine in the digestive tract and measures approximately 1.5 meters in length in adult human. As you can see in this picture. Now, anatomy of the large intestine. Large intestine is 1.5 to 1.8 meter in length, which is smaller than small intestine. Now, parts of large intestine, these are cecum, ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum and anal canal. So first we go ahead. Before that, we have to discuss the differences between the small and large intestine. So large intestine have no sacculations. Small intestine have no sacculations, whereas large intestine has sacculations. Sacculations are nothing but the bulging of large intestine at regular interval. Small intestine do not have tinea coli. Large intestine have got tinea coli, which is a outer longitudinal muscle fibers, which is aggravated in more number and more condensed in large intestine. Small intestine also has tinea coli, but not in that condensed form. This is the special feature to differentiate between the small and large intestine. In small intestine, there will be no appendices epiploike, but large intestine has appendices epiploike, which are, these are appendices epiploike. These are nothing but these are fat cells present in the serosal layer of large intestine. Then in small intestine, we have greater part which is freely mobile, except duodenum. Jejunum and ileum is freely mobile, but in large intestine, greater part is fixed. There are villi present in the small intestine, but villi are absent in large intestine. There are transverse folds found in both small intestine and large intestine, but transverse folds are permanent in large intestine, and whereas this is transitory in large intestine. Now, first part we'll describe as cecum, which is a large prime sac, commencement of large gut. It is situated in the right iliac fossa above lateral half of inguinal ligament. Its size measures around, length is 6 cm, breadth is 7.5 cm. It is a sac that extends inferiorly about 6 cm past the ileocecal junction. Appendix is attached to the cecum is a tube about 9 cm. Now, features in the interior of the cecum. It has two orifices. One is ileocecal orifice, second is appendicular orifice. Ileocecal orifice is present posterior to the medial wall and it is a transtubular and right lateral plane. And it has wall guarded by two lips. Appendicular orifice is 2 cm below and behind ileocecal junction. Now, we'll discuss about the vermiform appendix, which is a worm-like tubular diverticulum. It arises posterior medial wall of the cecum, which is 2 cm below the ileocecal junction. It is suspended by mesoappendix. It is a part of gut, but devoid of tinea coli, sacculation and appendices epiplicae, which is a main differentiating point between the small intestine and the large intestine. Large intestine have these three, tinea coli, sacculation and appendices epiplicae present, but vermiform appendix is a part of large intestine, but it is devoid of these three. Now about measurements, it is 2 cm to 20 cm. It has got three parts: base, body tip and mesoappendix. Now very important point is discussed regarding this appendix, which is the McBurney's point, which is represented by a point at the junction of medial 2/3 and lateral 1/3 of a line joining umbilical to right anterior superior iliac spine. This is a point of maximum tenderness in appendicitis, which is called as Rowling's sign. It has got a keen feature that when we deep press, pain will be slightly less, but as soon as we put our hand away from this point, the tenderness will be more. This is a Rowling sign, which is a keen feature of this appendicitis, because this McBurney's point is very tender point in which is found in this appendicitis. It has got different classification according to its positions. At 11 o'clock position, which is subcecal and paracolic, which is also called as paracolic, which is found in 2% of population. Another is 12 o'clock classification position, which is retrocecal or retrocolic, which is found in 60% of people. 2 o'clock position, it is a splinting type 1, which is found in 2%, which is pre or posterior. Now 3 o'clock position, this is also called as promontoric type, which is rarely found in people. It is horizontal in position. 4 o'clock position, which is pelvic type, this is in 30% of population, which is pointing towards uterine tube or ovary. And last one is 6 o'clock position, which is very rare. This is complete down, which is called as mid inguinal type also. So further we are discussing about colon. It is the last part of the digestive system in most vertebrates. It extracts water and salt from solid waste before they are eliminated from the body, and is the site in which flora added fermentation of unabsorbed material occurs. Unlike the small intestine, the colon does not play a major role in absorption of food and nutrients. However, the colon does absorb water, sodium and some fat soluble vitamins. So the colon consists of 4 sections: ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon. So ascending colon extends superiorly from the right colic flexure near the liver, where it turns to be the left. It is a small caliber than cecum. Its function is to remove the water and other key nutrients from waste material and recycle it back into the body. Transverse colon, it extends from the right colic flexure to the left colic flexure near the spleen, where the colon turns inferiorly. It is the longest and most movable colon. Its function is to serve as a reservoir for liquid that comes from the small intestine and also absorption of water and other substances. Now descending colon extends from the left colic flexure to the pelvic, and it's to store feces that will be emptied into the rectum. Now sigmoid colon forms an S-shaped
tube that extends medially and then inferiorly into the pelvic cavity and extends at the rectum. It forms a loop which average is about 40 cm in length and normally lies within the pelvis. And its function is to store fecal matter until the body is ready to expel it out. So now we'll describe in detail ascending colon. This is the upward continuation of the cecum, which ends at right colic flexure just below the liver, measures around 5 inches and anteriorly, and on sideways it is covered by peritoneal, and it has got on either side paracolic gutters which are found on both the sides, which collects the fluid here. Now, difference between the transverse colon and descending colon, it's like transverse colon extension we have already learned in previous slide. Transverse colon, it is completely covered by the peritoneum, so it is and has mesentery called as transverse mesocolon. Descending colon, it is from left colic flexure to the pelvic brim. Continuous blow as the sigmoid colon, length is 10 inches and it is covered by peritoneum from front and sideways. That means it is also retroperitoneal. It has also got paracolic gutters on its both sides. Now, pelvic sigmoid colon. Its position is left iliac fossa and in pelvic cavity, which measures around 15 inches. It is completely covered by peritoneum and a mesentery called pelvic mesocolon. Crypt's mucosal lining of the colon contains numerous straight tubular glands and contain many mucus producing goblet cells. Tinea coli, it is a longitudinal smooth muscle layer of the colon, does not completely envelop the intestinal wall but forms 3 bands. Now, another part, which is most fixed part, it is also retroperitoneal. Rectum, its situation, it's fixed, it's that's why we can locate it very easily. This is its situation is sacrum 3, 4, 5 and till coccyx 1. Its length is 5 inches lower part from the rectal ampulla, and it is very sensitive in nature, so whenever it is distended, overloaded, it has leads to desire to defecate, and it has got two curves, two anterior posterior and 3 lateral curves, and it has got peritoneal relations divided into 3 part: upper 1/3, middle 1/3 and lower 1/3. Upper 1/3 is from front and sides, middle 1/3 from front, lower 1/3 is devoid of peritoneum. It has got 2 mucosal folds. One is longitudinal fold, which is transitory, horizontal fold, which is also called Huston's valves, which are permanent. Now, rectum is a straight muscular tube that begins at the termination of the sigmoid colon and ends at the anal canal. The muscular tuning is a smooth muscle and it is relatively thick in the rectum compared with the rest of the digestive tract. And it is continuous above with the sigmoid colon, while below it ends in anal canal. From its origin at the level of the 3rd sacral vertebra, it passes downward and extends for about 2.5 cm in front of and a little below, and the tip of the coccyx as far as apex of the prostate. You can see in this picture. Now the final part, anal canal. It is a terminal part of the alimentary canal. Its extent is from anorectal junction and it opens exteriorly at the anal orifice. It has got sphincter and eye muscles surrounds the canal and it keep it closed except during defecation. So this is the last 2 to 3 centimeter of the digestive tract. The external and anal sphincter at the inferior end of the anal canal is formed by skeletal muscles. Its measurement is length is 3.8 cm. It has got 2 lines, pectinate line, which is from mucocutaneous junction of the anal canal, which correspond with the anal valves. Another is Hilton's line, represented by the anal intersphincteric groove at the lower end of the internal sphincter muscle. Interior of anal canal. It is divided into three parts. Upper part, which is mucus, 15 mm. You got anal columns, which are also called as column of Mogagni, anal valves, anal papillae, anal sinuses, anal glands. Second is mid part, which is pectin or transitional jaw, measures around 15 mm. And third is lower part, anal verge, cutaneous, which is cutaneous, 8 mm in size. It has got two types of sphincter ani, internus, which is internal anal sphincter ani externus, which is external anal sphincter, which is deep, superficial and subcutaneous part. You can see in this picture, external anal sphincter and internal anal sphincter and anal canal. Now, arterial supply of the colon. It has got two main sources, superior mesenteric artery, which rises from midgut, inferior mesenteric artery, which rises from hindgut. Now, whole of the large intestine is supplied by superior mesenteric artery through ileocolic artery, right colic artery, medial colic artery, and from inferior mesenteric artery, which is from hindgut, it is by superior left colic artery and internal inferior left colic artery. Now, venous drainage, it is drained through superior and inferior mesenteric veins. Lymph drainage, it follows same, its arterial supply to into epiploic nodes, wall of the colon, paracolic nodes between marginal artery and part of the bowel, intermediate nodes, main vessels along colic arteries, central nodes, superior and inferior vessels. Now, the nerve supply of the colon, it is again parasympathetic, is supplied from vagus, and most of the midgut, cecum, ascending and right 2/3 of the transverse colon is supplied by vagus stimulation, and another hind part is supplied by pelvic splenic nerve S2, S3, S4, and it supplies the left 1/3 of the transverse colon, descending and sigmoid colons. Sympathetic is derived from greater splenic nerve and lesser splenic nerve. Now, function of the large intestine: absorbing water, absorption of vitamins, reducing acidity and protecting from infections, producing antibodies. We'll discuss in great detail. The large intestine takes about 16 hours to finish the digestion of the food. It removes water and any remaining absorbable nutrients from the food before sending the indigestible matter to the rectum. The colon absorbs vitamins, which are created by the colonic bacteria, such as vitamin K, especially important as the daily ingestion of vitamin K is not normally enough to maintain adequate blood coagulation, vitamin B12, thiamine and riboflavin. It also compacts feces and stores fecal matter in the rectum until it can be discharged via the anus in defecation. The large intestine also secretes K+ potassium and chloride secretion increases in cystic fibrosis. Recycling of various nutrients takes place in colon. Example include fermentation of carbohydrates, short chain fatty acid and urea cycling. Defecation is the final act of digestion by which organism eliminates solid, semi-solid or liquid waste material, feces, from the digestive tract via the anus. Waves of muscular contraction known as peristalsis in the walls of the colon move fecal matter through the digestive tract towards the rectum. Undigested food may also be expelled this way. This process is called as ingestion. Normal functioning defecation reflex. A normal functioning defecation reflex produces as a muscular contraction that serves as a signal to the body that it is time to move the bowel and eliminate stool. Prompt response to the defecation reflex by going to the bathroom when it is activated prevents stool from drying out and becoming difficult to pass. The defecation reflex may be triggered about 45 minutes to an hour upon rising from sleep, after drinking a hot beverages, or after eating a meal. The defecation reflex will disengage after about 15 minutes of being ignored. Like any other muscle that is not used, it will break down and fail to function if continuously ignored. If continuously ignored, you may have a feeling of unsatisfactory defecation. When the defecation reflex is ignored, constipation will result as the stool that is retained in the colon becomes dried out, hard and difficult to pass. Retained waste can be stressed out the rectal sac. A stressed out rectal sac requires more and more stool to fill the rectal sac before the reflux will be activated. The causes even more stool to dry out as it collects behind the previously retained stool. Thank you. I hope you have understood the anatomy of the large intestine.